Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, O merciful God, that your church, being gathered together in unity by your Holy Spirit, may show forth your power among all peoples, to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Joshua. Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to session and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel. And they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, now therefore revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us along all the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who live in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
The second reading is from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly, as I must speak. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever." He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard this, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe, and who was the one who would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Trust me. No two words have fostered greater suspicion, greater mistrust, greater fear than the call to trust. I have an instinctive fear reaction to the words "trust me." Nobody wants to hear "trust me" from their auto mechanic, their babysitter, their brain surgeon. Yet trust is exactly what Jesus wants us to do. If we want to follow Jesus, we need to trust him. This is a difficult teaching. Who can accept it? When asked to trust Jesus, many grumbled and many just left. It's the same old story. When the Hebrews wandered in the wilderness, God sent them manna, bread from heaven. They ate the bread and immediately complained about it. They could not trust that God would continue to care for them. They could not surrender themselves to that day-by-day living, that daily gratitude, that daily surrender that marks a relationship with God. And now Jesus is the bread from heaven. He has just told the crowds that he is the bread of life sent from heaven. He is the new manna. If they eat his flesh and drink his blood, they will abide in him and they will live. Now, if the crowds took him literally, then of course cannibalism is a scandal. But they have already been fed, literally. Jesus had just fed thousands of them with just a little bread and fish. And they have been listening to Jesus speak in metaphor and parables for a long time. So I think the real scandal is not the literal meaning of Jesus' words. The real scandal is trust. When Jesus invites us to eat his flesh and drink his blood, when he says he is the bread from heaven, Jesus invites us to trust him completely, to surrender our lives to him. Just as the Hebrews did in the desert, we can learn to trust God, that whatever we need, God will either provide or give us the means, the insight, the wisdom, and the courage to obtain it. The second part is important because there is a wrong way to trust, and that is to do so blindly. I trust God,
but I still look both ways before crossing the street. I trust God, but I still lock my door at night. I trust God, but I still get vaccinated and I still wear a mask. Trusting God does not mean we give up our brains. Trusting God means we give up ourselves. Our relationship with God is marked by dependence and surrender. We surrender our will and our lives to the guidance and care of the one who created us. We know that we depend on God for everything, for blessings large and small, for our income and the means to get it, for our relationships, for our safety and the means to preserve it, for our every thought and our every living breath. When we trust God, we acknowledge that everything we have comes from God, and that among what we have is the gift of God's very self. God holds nothing back from us, and we can return the gesture by withholding nothing of our lives from God. Total trust. Ignatius of Loyola put it this way: act as if everything depended on you. Trust as if everything depended on God. Ignatius had a complicated relationship with the concept of faith. He began his young life, as one biographer described, as a rough, violent, and punkish swordsman who was eventually wounded in battle. He underwent several painful surgeries in the days before anesthetic to repair a shattered leg. During his agonizing recovery, Ignatius had a spiritual awakening. He devoted his life to trusting God and teaching others a life of contemplative prayer and service. This transformation did not happen all at once. Ignatius experienced a form of blind trust, an immature step on his spiritual journey, when he encountered a Muslim man who questioned his beliefs in Jesus and said a few choice words about the Virgin Mary. After the Muslim had gone on his way, Ignatius prayed for guidance on what to do. He decided that if his mule followed the Muslim's path, that was a sign that God meant for him to follow and kill the man. Fortunately, the mule chose a different path. This is an example of blind trust and immature faith, and the fact that Ignatius tells this story in his autobiography shows that he was humble enough and divorced enough from his ego to relay a story that made him look dangerously misguided. Over the years, Ignatius grew up quite a bit. He advocated for emptying the self of ego, and he devoted himself to teaching others his own methods of cultivating a trusting relationship with God. And so we have our own journey that can always lead to deeper trust in God. There are no gray areas in Jesus' world. In the gospel, he describes three groups of people: believers, non-believers, and villains. So when it comes to our relationship with Jesus, we are either all in or we are not in. Now, I tend to balk at making statements like that because I know that real life is usually more complicated. When we have a lot of demands on our attention and our time, it is difficult for us to be all in on anything. Total trust of God? I'm just happy to get the laundry folded. How can we go all in on our relationship with God when it seems like life has gone all in on us? The solution is simple. Just start. God demands nothing but welcomes everything. Trust God to lead you into an all-in relationship on God's own time, but be sure to follow where God leads. The scandal of trust is that it really is easy once we get over our fear to rely on God for our every breath, to trust God with our whole selves, to let our egos decrease and God increase. Once we get started with that first step, we can greet Jesus' invitation to trust him by partaking of his flesh with joy rather than fear. And we can rejoice to hear Jesus say, the one who eats this bread will live forever. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand. Let us affirm our faith by saying together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father,
the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord,
Jesus Christ,
the only Son of God,
eternally begotten of the Father,
God
from God,
light from light, true God from true God,
begotten, not made, of one being with the Father,
through him all things were made.
For us and for our salvation,
he came down from heaven.
By the power of the Holy Spirit,
he became
incarnate from the Virgin Mary,
and was made man.
For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate.
He suffered death
and was buried.
On the third day
he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven,
and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory
to judge the living and the dead,
and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord,
the giver of life,
who
proceeds from the Father and the Son.
With
the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified.
He has spoken
through the prophets.
We believe
in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We
look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work. For this community, the nation, and the world. For the just and proper use of your creation. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For the peace and unity of the Church of God. For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Daniel, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers. For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, we pray for those who have asked for our prayers, especially Beth, Devin, Jerry's family, Jim, Michael, Kyle, the Vicker family, David, Mark, Michael, the Smith family, Rebecca's family, Mary's family, Grandma Moon, Roy, James, the Carumbo family, Vincent, the Avery family, the Cohen family, the Phillips family, Grace, Scott, Jeff, Eddie, Alexandra, the Laufer family, Edwina, the Spencer family, Kara, Megan, and Leonard. Hear us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, for those who are beginning school this week, and those who are celebrating birthdays or anniversaries this week. And for all our thanksgivings. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins.
Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Good morning. Please have a seat for the announcements. It's really wonderful to be back and to see you all. And it's wonderful to welcome. Thank you. We missed you too. It's wonderful to welcome each of you who are here with us this morning. And a hello to all of those who are worshiping with us through Facebook or the website today. Hurricane Henry permitting. Join us in Rittenhouse Square today after the service for a bring your own coffee, tea, water, or whatever for a socially distanced gathering with friends. Bishop Gutierrez, Bishop of the Diocese of Pennsylvania, will be visiting our church on October 3rd. If you are interested in being confirmed or received, please talk to me or to Rachel by the beginning of September so we can start to prepare you. If you wish to give a gift today to support the church and all the staff and programming that we do, you may do so during the offertory anthem. If you are in person today, there's an offering plate near the bulletins. If you're watching from home or you would prefer to give electronically, you can text CHT Donate to 73256. You can press Learn More on our Facebook page or click the Donate button on the top of our website homepage. I'd also like to draw your attention, if you haven't already noticed it, to the scaffolding in the back of the church and up in the gallery. We are deep into the installation for our new organ, and I almost want to applaud that too, because it has been a long journey, and we are finally in the tangible and visible stage of watching this magnificent instrument assemble and come to life in our space. And the offertory sentence comes from the letter to the church in Rome. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Thank you.
God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Those that are not taking communion today or are with us at home, we'll say together the prayer for spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart, as though you have already come. I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Thank you.
We'll continue with the post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Amen. Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God.